am so pleased that she has come from Brisbane to join us right here in Kansas City. If you would, put your hands together and welcome.
Thank you, Laura, for that lovely introduction. In fact, I did meet Laura earlier today, and I had the great privilege of being able to go through the museum. And in spite of the fact that Australia was involved in World War One for much longer than the US, and has had a history of remembering World War One. It was the Anzac tradition in Australia. We don't have a museum dedicated to just to World War One. And it's for those of you who haven't been through the museum, I've been through a lot of war museums researching the novel, and it's a terrific museum. It's right from the time you walk across the poppies that are just, I mean, that blew me away, that and the two videos, one at the beginning and one at the end, which I learned things I didn't know about the war, which was terrific. This is the first time I'm speaking publicly in the US about my novel In Falling Snow. I've done lots of talks in Australia. And I'm very thankful to the museum for hosting tonight, and also to Penguin USA under Catherine Court, who decided ultimately to take the risk on a little Australian author and publish the novel. I'm thrilled, really, that this story, the true story on which this is based, is coming to a wider audience. And you'll know why when I finish. And that's really what I'm gonna do tonight, is talk about how I came to write this book, and in that way tell you sort of, I guess, a little bit the true story that it's about. And the marvellous women of Roermond, as they came to be known. I'll start at the very beginning. I was in the wrong aisle. There's a story I'll tell at the end if we have time, but I was in the wrong aisle at the University of Queensland Library about 12 years ago, and I was in the wrong aisle because I transposed two digits in a call number, and I was looking for a book to research my second novel that had a skeleton that was 200 years old, and I needed the skeleton to have been preserved. So I was looking for an anatomy text called What Happens When You Die. Because I was in the wrong aisle, I was never going to find the anatomy text. But I don't know why it caught my eye, but there was a red spine, and the book was Women of Roermond, a Scottish Women's Hospital on the Western Front. I can't tell you why I pulled the book out, but I did. I have Scottish ancestors. It said on the Western Front in World War One. I studied World War One at school. I'm interested in women's sort of stories. But I pulled this book out, and the book tells this marvellous story about the women of Roermond. They were the Scottish Women's Hospitals Association under the leadership of a Scottish doctor, Elsie Inglis, who, when World War One was declared, they decided that they were doctors, nurses, ambulance drivers and orderlies, that they were going to establish a number of hospitals through Europe. They offered the British their hospital, and the War Office wrote back and told them to go home and sit still. So they offered their services to the French, who said, that's fantastic, and we have a 12th century Cistercian Abbey that's all ready for immediate occupation. So 16 of them embarked from England under the leadership of Dr. Francis Ivans. When they got to the Abbey, there was no electricity, no heating. Horses, the German cavalry had stayed in one of the lower rooms. There were still British soldiers in the stables. And the 16 women within a month had set up a working hospital. And I sat down in the library and started reading. I forgot about What Happens When You Die. And I didn't stop sort of reading until the library closed, and I took the book home and I finished it that night. Because I mean, to me, this was just an extraordinary story. And what I really wondered is, why did I not know this? Why do more people not know this? And, you know, in the 12 years since, I haven't met anyone who's heard of the hospital that was established at Roermond Abbey, the real Abbey. And so I did think, gee whiz, this would make a marvellous setting for a novel. I should have said at the beginning, some of you are probably historians. I am not a historian, I'm a novelist. Margaret Atwood says that our job is to create plausible whoppers for the rest of you. I have no loyalty or faith or fidelity to history, and I'm not required to have any. But anyway, I thought, wouldn't this make a great scene for a novel? But of course, that's a setting. It's not a plot. It's not a story. And for me, all of my novels have had that sort of intellectual trigger, something. And that was definitely a something. It was a sort of a something that thumped me in the chest with fascination. But a few months after that, my maternal grandmother died, and I'd been very close to my Nana growing up. She was one of those magic grandmothers. I think she was probably a difficult mother, as strong women often are, but she was a wonderful grandmother. And she passed away. I can remember I was in Melbourne in Australia at the time, and my uncle called and told me that Nana had gone, and I went to St. Patrick's and lit a candle. In the months that followed, I thought a lot, I reflected a lot on my grandmother's life. She was born in 1898, and she grew up in the country in Queensland. She was a very bright person who had none of the opportunities that I've had in my life for education or for a career. And I started to think about, I wonder how my Nana's life might have been different if instead of marrying my grandfather and working in his medical practice, she, who was a nurse, had gone over to Europe and had somehow been waylaid by Dr. Ivans on her way to Roermond and had gone with the party to Roermond. I needed a reason my grandmother would go to Europe, because my grandmother wouldn't have gone to Europe. And so then I thought, well, she could have a young brother, Tom, who's underage, who's 15, who runs away to war. And she's sent by the family, by her father, to bring Tom home. And so now you see we have the beginnings of a plot and a story. I thought so that my character is Iris Crane, and she goes to war ostensibly to bring Tom home, and she meets Miss Frances Ivans and is just sort of, you know, swept off her feet literally and finds herself at Roermond. Having said all that and having sort of this idea in my head, I really didn't want to write a novel about World War I. I didn't want to for a number of reasons, mainly that I'd read many novels of World War I and they were marvellous, and I thought, I don't really think I can add anything of value to that. Even so, I had this idea in the back of my mind and I started doing some more reading. I read anything that had been written about Roermond and the women who served there. There's Eileen Crofton's history that I mentioned, I read that again. There was also another history written in 1917 or 18 by Count de Navarro, that's much more current, that tells you lots of things that happened at the Abbey. And I started reading stories, memoirs, letters, anything I could get my hands on, written by nurses and doctors who'd served in World War I. Any of that served at Roermond, I read many accounts that they'd written, got access to the archives. And I started to sort of build, I think, a knowledge of another part of the war, if you like. So the war hospital and Roermond itself, which was very different from the kind of what was going on in the battles in lots of ways. I still found the women fascinating, the real women who'd worked at Roermond. And so once I had Iris, I started sort of just writing little bits and pieces. I don't think Google was a doing word in those days, but I looked up on the internet and I found that the Abbey still exists. And so I wrote to them, and they had an artist in residence program, and I was very lucky to be able to go and spend 2 weeks in the Abbey, which was just fantastic because I could walk the corridors. I went up the stairs where the women would carry. So the hospital was staffed entirely by women, so the women would carry stretchers up the stairs. I could see the Canada ward and all the wards where they were. My sense of direction is very poor, but I worked out as best I could where things were. And the Abbey is still there. It's a cultural foundation for France. The other thing that happened while I was there is that Roermond is, I think when I was there, there were French dancers and Italian musicians, and I was sort of in between on my residency, and my French is not good enough to carry on a conversation, and my Italian doesn't exist, so I didn't really have anyone to talk to much. And I ran out of books in English to read, because I'd taken a whole lot with me, and I wasn't getting to Paris to get some. So I didn't have anything to read, I didn't have anyone to talk to, which meant I became more and more quiet. And One of the things that had struck me in all the things I'd read about Roermond itself is that it was like a haven in the midst of the chaos. It was never bombed. They were very close to the bombing. They never had anything awful happen there. And so I got this sense, Iris tells us she thinks Roermond is a holy place, and I got this sense of this protected space. It's built by Louis the Ninth, who was Saint Louis when he was 16. So it's a, you know, it's a really an amazing place. And so I went to Roermond, which was, you know, a really terrific thing to be able to do. I still was hesitant to write about war. But I discovered that my grandfather, who I knew had fought in both wars, World War I and World War II, British and Australian Army, had been an underage soldier, like Tom in the novel. And I think when I found that out, I started reading many, many more stories of these young soldiers, particularly young soldiers. You just can't read, you can't go to this museum and read this material without thinking about these young people and what happened to them. I mean, the youngest known British soldier was 12. What happened to them that changed not only their lives, but the lives of their families, of their children, of their children's children. And really, that was the thing that I really want to explore in relation to the war, is that cost that sort of went on and on through generations. Certainly in Australia, and in England, but here too. And I should have said at the outset that while America wasn't involved in the war until 1917, the American Red Cross was a major contributor to Roermond Hospital from the beginning, and it was the women's movement. They were suffragettes, the women who started Roermond. They'd started it before the war. They were suffragists, keen on getting the vote, and they put that cause aside for the duration of the war. And so then I spent 10 years writing the novel and doing some other things in between. But I'm not the most efficient writer in the world. In fact, I think I'm going backwards on the information superhighway. My first novel I typed up on the Mac Classic 2, and I didn't show anyone until I'd done a whole manuscript. This novel, I hand-wrote most of it. I got to my second novel, and the computer file just seemed too linear. So now I handwrite, and that just takes a long time. And I just write little bits and pieces and then eventually pull them together into a perfectly plotted, lovely, easy to understand novel. That isn't actually what happens, but eventually it comes together into a novel. I struggled for a long time with In Falling Snow in particular about when Iris might be telling her story from. Should it be just after the war? And awful things happened to Iris during the war, and that just was too raw. Should it be some years later? And I eventually decided that it'll be many, many years later, and Iris will be an old, old woman invited back to Roermond, where these things that changed her life entirely happened. And so we get that long view of the effect of war. And I also really love writing an old lady. It was just, you know, she could be grumpy with the person up the shop, and she could sort of, you know, say what she say or speak her mind in the way that old. And I just, that was, I think that'll be a highlight of my writing life, would be to write from the point of view of an octogenarian woman, as she tells us she is. When I had enough of the novel in some sort of shape, I went on a residency at the Banff Centre in Canada. It sounds like novelists only travel, doesn't it? You know, someone has to create culture for the rest of you. I don't actually spend my whole life travelling, but the Banff Centre for the Arts in Canada is a marvellous resource. I don't know if you have something like that in the US. We don't have anything like it in Australia. And it's a centre where artists, musicians, dancers, singers, they're musicians, visual artists, go to this one place and writers and work on projects. And so I went and I pulled the novel together in the 7 months that I was in Canada. I'd been there before, but for the visit that I did in Falling Snow, my circumstances had changed. I had a 10-year-old son, and so he came with me and went to Banff Elementary School. So it was a very different experience from the first time where I could, you know, become a precious, difficult artist. You can't do that when you're also being a mother. But it was a terrific opportunity to pull the novel together. I think that for me, the novel that I wrote quite serendipitously, novelists, it's not their job to tell you what to think, or at least I don't think it is. It's not my job. I never presume to do that. But the novel is set in two really key times in our history. One is World War I, where women had just this moment when their lives might be different, when things might change for them. And then in the 1970s, when Iris is old, but her granddaughter Grace is the first of the generation of women to have it all. She's practicing as an obstetrician. She has three children. She has an incredibly busy life, and she's about going insane, you know, because she just can't manage it all. And so these two periods, I think, are really interesting in not only the history of women, but the history of us as people. I'll finish my comments in a moment, and then we might have some discussion or questions. And then if there's time at the end, I'll do a reading. But I want to say this, that when Elsie Inglis, who ran the Women's Hospitals Association, died, Winston Churchill spoke at her funeral service, and he said that what she'd achieved in World War I, because Elsie had the hospital at Roermond, one in somewhere else in France and in Serbia. And I should say that while I said to you that I tell plausible whoppers, all of the Roermond things that happen in the novel, because every audience I've spoken to that when they come back to me by email or through the website say, that didn't really happen, did it? All of the Roermond things really did happen. This is what happens to novelists. The things you write that you make up, everybody believes. The things that you write that are based on the real world, nobody believes. So all the things that the women did at Roermond really happen. And many of the characters in the novel are based on the real women of Roermond. So Dr. Ivins, and many of the other women doctors, Cicely Hamilton, who's a playwright, and quite a few of them, but not Iris. Iris is made up, and her best friend Violet is made up, and Tom is made up. So just to say that. But when Elsie was died, Churchill said that her great achievements would never be forgotten. And yet in 2000, or whenever it was that I saw that story, they had been forgotten. I mean, I really haven't met anyone who's ever heard of the Scottish Women Doctors. And yet, by any yardstick, what they achieved was remarkable, or to me it was anyway. They were one of the finest hospitals in World War I. They had a record for fewer deaths, even though they were taking wounded from the Somme region, which was a terrible theatre of war. They had a reputation for doing fewer amputations, and they were the only hospital on the Western Front that when the French soldiers, who were treated very badly by their army, came with their ragged, terrible uniforms, they repaired them, they laundered them, and they sent them back to the front with toothbrushes, which I just, I think they were extraordinary women. So it's been my great privilege, really, to have the opportunity to share their story a little bit more widely than you can in a history, by framing it in a novel that sort of rollicks along. But really what I wanted to do was make sure that the novel honoured those women of Roermond. So I'd like to invite you to ask any questions or make any comments or tell me a story about your grandfather. I use a pen. Usually people ask what you are. Roermond is about, that's a good question, I should have said that. It's about, I think, 50 kilometres. It's an hour on a slow train, there's no fast train, north of Paris. And in fact, it doesn't really matter if you think I'm mad. When I was there, as well as kind of getting quiet and spiritual, it was a bit freakish being in this kind of French-speaking place. When I didn't speak, my French wasn't great. For even 2 weeks for a novelist is pretty hard. I'm very frightened of dogs, having been bitten by dogs a lot when I was a child. And Roermond now is still surrounded by a forest, But it's also an enclave for wealthy Parisians who've got their country houses there. And they own these enormous dogs that they keep there during the week while they're in Paris. And so I got to the stage where I was so frightened of the dogs that I couldn't walk downtown to get a coffee. And I had a colleague coming over from England, and I said, fantastic, we'll be able to go downtown together, I'm feeling a bit. In Australia we call it cabin fever, but in Canada they call it shack nasty. And so my friend came, and we go out one morning, and I'm thinking, great, you know, she can see how terrible these dogs are. And the first house we see, there's a little tiny white poodle that waddles up to the fence and sort of wags its sort of what's left of its tail. And my friend turns to me and says, are these the dogs you were talking about? it's well worth a visit. You can visit it on the weekend. So if you're ever over in Paris and you've got a spare day, it is a beautiful place. The abbey was torn down in the French Revolution, so that the church is no longer there. There's the cloister, and all that's left of the abbey itself is this one solitary tower. It was 2 metres shy of Notre Dame, Paris, when it existed. So it's so sad they tore it down, but you've still got the cloister and the abbey buildings. Marvellous place. Yeah.
To give us an idea of the impact on Australia, what was the population of Australia at the time? How many served in the war? What were the deaths and the wounded? Do you know those?
No,
I was just asking.
I don't know the numbers. What I can tell you is that in small towns, you know, there were families that lost 2 and 3 boys.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, and that's the little bit I'll read at the end. But and in my town, which is a big city, it was little towns then. So Ithaca, would have been in the hundreds, not the thousands. And our war memorial, you know, is all four sides have got names of young men. I go every year. We take my son up to the Anzac Day service at 8 o'clock, and I keep it together really well until the children's choirs start singing in Flanders Fields, and I just, you know, there's young soldiers up on the monument, modern soldiers who are guarding the monument at rest. There's a boy from the Boys Brigade plays the last post, and you know, you just cannot fail to be moved by, and so these families. So there's just list after list after list of them. So it was totally. Took over Australia's life. You know, there weren't just no young men, really, you know, after the war. Other questions, comments?
I just wanted to hear more about what happened when you got quiet. How was that related to your book? What happened
to
your book?
So to me, it was, I really experienced, you have to be quiet for some periods when you're a writer. It's like being a rabbit in headlights, really. When you've got a book come out, you have this 15 minutes and then you go back to your room. I think that it was, I found the Abbey to be a deeply spiritual place, and I think that's what I connected with. And so I was reading lots of accounts of the war and lots of, and I'd read the history of the women of Rouen over and over again. And so I started to get a sense of the place. The place is almost a character in the novel as a result. That's what I'd say was the effect of that. I didn't answer your question, did I?
That's fine.
I recently started another book about Australian nurses, and by Keneally.
Oh, yes.
Is that, were you writing, did you know, at about the same time?
No, his book, I think, came out after mine, and I haven't read it as yet. I loved his Schindler's List, but I haven't read, I can't even remember the title of it.
Daughters of Mars? Daughters.
Yeah.
And it hasn't done as well as your book has in Australia, has it?
No.
Even though Keneally is a famous Australian writer.
Yes. Yeah. I'm trying to remember the story. The story is quite different. So this is about a group of women who started a hospital, and you know, it's that setting. Whereas I think his is about two women.
Sisters, I think.
Hmm?
Yes.
They're sisters, and and they'd been nurses, and don't they euthanize their mother or something?
Well, I guess my question more, and I didn't want to steal your thunder, but if you were to have known about that, are the authors in Australia fairly collaborative, or is it fairly individual process, or does it depend upon?
Well, from, I work with a writing friend on my manuscripts, but know that it's not like an assignment, and you wouldn't do it because somebody else. Because what I would pull from the war would be different from what any other writer would pull from the war, you know. And that was the thing that nearly stopped me, and I'm really, not his novel in particular, but that I'd read such wonderful novels, Birdsong, Sebastian Faulks, and the fellow who's never been popular here, and I don't know why, Sebastian Barry, It's a Long, Long Way. Those two novels are such beautiful. I know Pat Barker is very popular here, but to me those two others are just beautiful books about World War I. But this isn't, you know, I hate to say that it is a book set in World War I, but it's a bit of World War I that you wouldn't normally see, because it's very much interior to this hospital and the experiences of the women, who were sort of healing rather than part of the harm. There's only very glimpses of the sort of...
You don't have great battle scenes and things. Keneally does, isn't that the truth?
Oh, I don't know.
His book does.
No, I don't have any battle scenes.
But yours is, a very different kind of book.
No, I don't. There are no battle scenes. Any other questions? Yeah.
What's a sugar glider?
Okay, that's a great question, because in Australia, have you started the novel or read the novel?
I was page four.
Okay. So let me tell you, can I tell the story about the sugar glider? In the Australian version of the novel, it's not a sugar glider, it's a possum. And in Australia, a possum is the cutest little marsupial you've ever seen. They are beautiful little animals. Well, they live in the roof and they're a bit troublemaking, but they're native and they're lovely animals. They're pests in New Zealand, where they've taken over, but in Australia they're native animals. But when the manuscript hit the US, the editor said, "You can't have a possum." And I said, "Why not?" And she said, "Because they're like rats here. Nobody likes possums. They hate them." And they said, "You can have a bunny." And I said, "Well, there aren't any bunnies in Queensland. You know, like they're sort of not, you're not allowed to have bunnies. They're illegal because they, went crazy." So my husband came up with the idea, tell them it's a sugar glider. And a sugar glider is actually a possum. But I said it's a sugar glider, and I sent a picture. And the editor said, "Oh, isn't he cute?" It's a sugar glider. And there would have been sugar gliders, at that time in Brisbane. I didn't want to delete it altogether, because it's very symbolic of Iris as a sort of caring, nurturing person, because she looks after. Iris finds a baby possum on her trip home, and she sits down on the footpath and then can't get up again. And it's a tiny, they're this big. And sugar gliders, what's different with them is that they don't fly, they glide. So they've got webbing between their front and back legs, and they go through trees. They're great to watch, very fast. Yeah, it's a great question. Any other questions? Yeah?
So, influenza. Did that hit...
1919, that was, wasn't it? Or straight after the war, 1918.
Well, there was a little bit in, only because I was, my great aunt was a nurse in Hoa, and so I was reading her journal.
Yeah.
And so she wrote that they, that men would come in the morning and die by night.
Yes.
And so I didn't know if that touched the women.
Well, many of them stayed on after the armistice. Many of the women stayed on at the hospital to help treat the epidemic. And there was a nurse who, in the early, the one nurse who died, I think, died of influenza early in the war. But so it wasn't the epidemic, but it was. I'm fairly sure that that's what. And in the novel, Violet, who's Iris's best friend, gets very, very sick. With an influenza, but she died. I'm not going to give away.
That was the hard part. I'm like, what do I say?
Any other questions? Have we got,
Did you, in the book, do you talk about the impact of all these boys being killed? And of course, in Europe, 9 million or whatever it was. I mean, do you discuss that in here?
Well, this is a novel, so it's not.
But I mean, you go into
it's a history. Yes. Yeah, the novel is certainly. So the women of Royaumont, interestingly, some of them were patriotic, and some of them really were against the war, and they all joined together in order to heal rather than do more harm. So that there were interesting views in the place itself. But yes, there were three things that really struck me powerfully about soldiers and war that are very, very strong in the novel. One is the underage soldiers, the boy soldiers. So not just Tom, who's Iris's brother, but there were, you know, there were many, many, many young English boys who went and served at war, in the war, you know, as young as 12, which is just unthinkable. The second thing was the African soldiers. So the French colonies in Africa, they would send recruiters who would just really round up a whole lot of boys from a village and put them on a boat and take them to France, where they'd never been. They'd never, you know, have seen guns. They had no idea who they were fighting or why. And so there were a lot of them at Royaumont, the French African soldiers. The third thing was something that the Australian Army didn't do, but the French and British armies did. I don't think the Americans did, which was when soldiers, I think, were frightened and hid and ran away, they shot them as cowards or deserters. And to me, that was just, the Australian Army didn't do it. They commuted their sentences because our army was all volunteers. And so General, whoever it was, said, I can never remember his name, the Australian General, we won't. But so those three things were so powerful to me that, yes, they're there. And certainly, it's not a novel that pretends the war didn't happen and they all had a fun time at Royaumont. It's very much about those years and how those years cost us so greatly on and on and on through history. Any other?
Yeah. Have you been back to the Abbey since you completed the novel?
I have not.
How did it affect you? So
yeah, I have not. I just feel so privileged to have been able to go there to research the novel. It certainly helped, you know, put the place in context. And I will go back there when I next go to Europe. If anyone's thinking of funding a I'd be open to any sort of patronage that anyone suggests. Other questions?
Well, I was just wondering, since he mentioned that, is there any talk of having your book translated into French?
Yes, that's my Australian agent. Has got, now just let me get this right, an office in London, and they're negotiating that. Those take ages to do. Mm-hmm. Do you know what though? It's a long book, or it's longish, and so that puts them off these days. Mm-hmm. Publishing, I was saying to Dick, who's here from Penguin, before we started, you know, readers and writers, we've become, in my lifetime, a cottage industry. You know, when I was a child, everybody read books all the time, but we're rare now. It's sort of interesting times, I guess. But yeah. And so I don't know. We'll see what happens with that. But it's in Australia and the UK and here and Canada so far. I think the UK have put it into a couple of countries as well. Yeah.
Were there any German soldiers there?
Yes. The Royaumont cared for the French soldiers, you know, and they did other things too. Like the French were dreadful to their army. They didn't feed them properly. They didn't have canteens, so that when they were moving, they didn't have anywhere to eat. So the hospital would give them, you know, beds. Just soldiers who were marching through, give them beds to sleep in and feed them and stuff. And they treated German soldiers on more than one occasion. They were not. angry at this, in the way that, you know, the soldiers were at each other. And that wonderful story, which I covered in the novel just a little bit, of the first Christmas, yeah. Where, I mean, imagine, and I read, I don't know if this is true, but I read that what happened, you know, they started, the Germans started singing Silent Night, and then the French and English started singing Silent Night. And they got up out of the trenches and went and shook each other's hands. Now, I read, and I don't know if this is true, that the generals behind of the British Army ordered the big guns to start firing again, mm-hmm. which meant everybody went back. And if they hadn't, could it have ended the war? Mm-hmm. Could it have ended right there? You know, if they'd all just said, no, we won't, you know, what an amazing thing to have had happen. You know, anyway.
I've got a three-part question, okay. And it actually tags into your comment that writers and readers have kind of become this cottage industry. Mm-hmm. And coming at it as someone from the museum and someone who, I mean, it just, it's electric reading letters of someone. Yeah. As a writer, what suggestions would you have for us to engage in that practice? Are there any tips that you would have to get each of us to begin writing a bit more than we do? Okay. And that's the first part. The second part is when these folks read your book, and they're going to want to know the other titles that they can pick up, and I neglected to mention those. So could you state those? And the third is back to the writing bit, which is I would imagine that they become people that you engage with over the period of time that you're writing. Do you have a favorite bit and a favorite part of the book?
Okay, so let me just, the first part of the question, I'm gonna sort of, mm-hmm. If you're interested in, are you talking about museum workers interested in?
No, I just mean that I think people should write more than we do. I think that is, as you mentioned earlier, I think that is something we are, that we are neglecting to do as much as has happened in the past, that we don't write letters even just as we used to.
Don't
just write.
Actually, I did a blog recently on handwriting because not many people handwrite, and I think it's a shame that we're losing. And here in the US, as in Australia, children are not taught cursive writing at school. And to the point that my son taught himself cursive writing because he likes handwriting, and he was told at school not to use it. He had to use Queensland script, which is really just printing drawn up. You know, like those D's with their endless sort of. But on the turning, the reason that as a novelist I look to letters and memoir to find ideas is that I'm really listening or reading for voice, which I think is really important. And I'll tell a little story that I was going to tell at the beginning. My mother was a journalist, and she met the children's writer Enid Blyton. You've heard of Enid Blyton. She was big in America, or not really?
No.
She wasn't big in America.
No.
Okay, so
no.
she was a
PhD.
Yeah, and she was a very, very big children's writer in England and in Australia. So it was a big deal when she came to Australia in the 1950s. And my mother got to go to a press conference out at the airport. The only place she was stopping was at the Brisbane airport, where it's, and there were journalists who'd come in from all over Australia, and my mother. And I can just sort of picture, I've got a photo of her in those days in a sort of white Panama hat and glasses and gloves. And so there she is in this sea of male journalists who've come from everywhere in this old hangar, which was the airport in those days, with this sort of overhead fan, it's really hot. And they're looking out as Miss Blyton shimmers across the tarmac, flagged by someone from the Australian publisher, who's going to introduce her, and someone from the Prime Minister's office, because it's really important. And Miss Blyton is dressed, as my mother will faithfully report in the next day's edition, in an aqua twinset and pearls. Looking just like the young Queen Elizabeth. And so she comes into the hangar, and there's a speech from the Prime Minister's man, an introduction from the publisher, and my mother notices that Miss Blyton doesn't say anything, and then it's time for questions. Now, in later versions of the story, my mother asked the first question, but in earlier versions of the story, it was a journalist from the Sydney Morning Herald who said, "Miss Blyton, where do you get the ideas for the Noddy stories?" Noddy was her character. And Miss Blyton sort of cocked her head, looked at the journalist like he was a dog that had asked a question, and said, "Why, Noddy tells me." Now, in our family, that was a story about mad writers, but I really think I understand what she meant. And so whenever I talk, I've done lots of talks to librarians and museum workers, not just about World War I, but about this process of creating life, which is what novelists do. And what I would encourage everybody to do is listen to Noddy, which really is that creative self that's in all of us. I don't actually believe that, you know, you've got creativity and you have, and I think we've all got as many stories as we ever need to tell in our heads. And it's just really a matter of sort of getting out of the way and getting it down, which is why I handwrite instead of typing, because it's a better pace for me. So, so that's what I'd say is, if you wanted some advice, I'd say listen to Noddy. The second part of your question, if people get on my website, which is just my name, all of the titles are there. And the third part of your question, I don't remember.
Do you, or do you have a favourite piece that you wrote, a favourite story or a nugget in your book that you thought?
Well, one thing I really loved about Roymont was that all of the staff were women, except for the chef. And this is true, so if you read the novel, you'll read that and think she made that up, and I didn't. And that was because the French Red Cross said, we can't have an English cook cooking for French soldiers. They must have a French chef. And so they did. Michelet, he was a three-star Michelin chef, if they called that in those days, who had a restaurant in Paris and was a wounded soldier who stayed on and cooked through the years of the war. So that was one. That's one of my favourite stories from Royaumont, I think. You know, just that it's staffed entirely by women except the cook. And now, if there's no other questions, I might. Have we got time for me to do a quick reading?
Yeah. I've got a really serious war kind of reading. I don't think I'll do that one. I think I'll do which is a bit about the cost of war. Someone was asking me about. I'm just getting my reading glasses. You know, I didn't used to wear any glasses, and now I've got two sets. Okay. So, has anyone actually read the whole novel? Isn't that good? Oh, you've read the whole novel, yes, yes. Okay. So this is from the beginning of the novel, when, I'm just going to take my jacket off, because you don't mind if I take my jacket off? I thought America was a cold place. Oh dear, having been to Canada. This is from the beginning of the novel. Iris has come back from the shop in her 80s, and she's had this invitation back to Roydermine. And we understand something happened there, but we don't know what it is. And so she's just starting to remember. And the novel really then alternates between the time in the 70s where her granddaughter Grace is sort of trying to boss her around, and she's planning to go back to Roymont on the one hand, and her memory is back. And what we discover is what happened there. There's a secret. In all my novels, there's a secret. I love secrets. We're at the first kind of recollection of the hospital and where she meets Miss Ivins. At first it was the summers I remembered, long warm days under the palest blue skies, the cornflowers and irises and forget-me-nots lining the road through the leaf forest, the buzz of insects going about their work. But now in my mind's eye, it's winter, that first winter we arrived. Miss Ivins and me alighting from the train in Vian, the darkness descending, no one to meet us. And there's Miss Ivins herself, charging ahead to walk, not a thought for our luggage, abandoned on the station platform when we'd failed to rouse the porter. Where's Monsieur Bouzier? Miss Ivins said, as if I might know. I shrugged, but she'd already moved off down the hill at a cracking pace. Even with my long stride, I could barely match her. It began to snow. Miss Ivins took no notice, walked on ahead, failing at first to see that I'd stopped, turning, seeing me, laughing, for I was looking straight up, my mouth wide open. Snow,
she said matter-of-factly. I must have looked blankly at her. You've never seen snow? No, I said, just in the winter, but nothing like this. Oh, it's wonderful stuff. We'll make angels tomorrow. By the time we turned into the Abbey grounds, the day was almost gone. The pines of the long drive were newly dusted with the snow, which also dotted our coats and Miss Ivins's hair. She looked wild, a little mad even. She charged ahead once more, the gravel along the drive crunching with an alarming efficiency under her boots. Snow makes the world quieter and louder at the same time, she said, quite loudly. Imagine never having seen snow, she said more softly, so softly I had to strain to hear, for I'd stopped again and was standing still. I was standing still, for when you round that last bend and begin along that long drive, you see Roermond Abbey for the first time, and you never forget it. Even at the end of that cold, amazing day, even with the wonder of my first snow at hand, the Abbey took my breath away. And the feeling in my heart, that feeling surprised me, for it was joy, joy and fear in about equal measure. I now know the name of that feeling to be awe. Until 3 months before, I'd only ever travelled between Stanthorpe, where I grew up, and Brisbane, less than 200 miles, the towns at each end with their proud little post offices and hotels as their architectural achievements, the space between them mostly bush. Roermond Abbey was some other order of place, a feat of engineering or evidence of God, depending on how you saw the world. To one side were the remains of the chapel, recollecting a structure that once nudged the spires of Paris's Notre Dame in size, but was now just one tall tower, looking as if it might topple over. Next to the church tower were the monks' building, menacing in the winter twilight. I could just make out the window recesses along the front wall. I know I was exhausted. My life at home had been simple, divided between Risdon and the Mater nursing quarters, with the occasional train trip to St. Joseph's to see one of Tom's teachers about something he'd done or hadn't done. Tom's her little brother, who largely raised. I knew from one day to the next what lay in front of me, and mostly it was much like what lay behind me. And now this, where every day was full of the strange. And through it all, the ship journey from Australia, the days in London, the Channel crossing, the days in Paris, in the back of my mind was that other thought that could creep up on me when I least expected it, as it did now. The thought of my brother Tom telling me of his plan to run away, me agreeing, letting him go, when Daddy said I should have stopped him. Tom now, just 15 years old, somewhere out there in this cold, fighting the wicked Germans. As we drew closer, I made out two large wooden doors. Darkness would soon be with us, but no light shone inside the Abbey. I looked to Miss Ivins, her hair flecked with snow, her arms out to the sides, hands not touching anything, those enormous boots. It was so cold now, my breath caught in my throat. The doors looked as if they hadn't been opened for years. Miss Ivins knocked, waited, said more to herself than to me, "Where the devil are they?" I still heard no sound, nor saw a light within. A notion lodged in my brain that there was no one here but us. It took hold quickly, the cold feeding my imagination. Miss Ivins was mad. She'd led me here to the pixie twilight on a merry chase, and her talk of drains and equipments and hospitals was nothing but a product of her madness. "Oh, Iris, you young fool, now look what you've done. Acted impulsively, followed your most wrong-headed instincts, followed this mad English woman, and here you are in the middle of a dark forest with no way back." I was not given to hysterics, but the cold, exhaustion, the newness of it all, Miss Ivins herself, so much larger than life, like a character from Dickens, made me less than logical. My excited mind worked quickly. What could we do? We had no lamp to walk by, and the road was rough in parts, but there had been a light in the window of the last house. If we could make it back, we might be able to beg a room. There was sure to be a train to Paris in the morning. I could be in Soissons by nightfall. I could be back at what I was supposed to be doing. Daddy need never know. And Miss Ivins, well, Miss Ivins could... Miss Ivins rapped on the door a second time, just as I was about to suggest that we go quickly now to try to reach somewhere before dark. The door swung open with a whine. Thank you very much.